Dear friends, we will continue with the 9th lecture on the first module on the course on health, safety and environmental management in offshore petroleum engineering under the braces of NPTEL IIT Madras. This lecture is a continuation of lecture 7 and 8 where we are discussing how to organize safety. In this lecture, we discuss certain essential protocols which are important and which can be very useful for a practicing professional engineers in offshore and petroleum engineering, by the way of which organizing safety can be enhanced. Some of the excerpts of these work permits etcetera are taken from ASAC Global Ambassador Mr. Jeetu Patel, and we thank for him for his support for this lecture. Let us ask a question: what are the factors that generally drive deep water exploration? It is essential to know these factors and what would be the influence of these factors on managing safety. We all understand that the energy demand in the global scenario is on the continuous growth. Traditional fields where oil exploration was happening is now getting exhausted because of shallow and medium water depths. Availability of oil is highly excluded. It also resulted in declining production and reserves, and therefore there is an extensive pressure on oil and gas companies to diversify the supply. Attractive production sharing contracts are now in place so that a scheme of E&P, what we call as exploration production, if it is made more attractive, then one can think about a global business link between different oil fields in the world. And we have already seen there has been a continuous technological advent in designing, developing, commissioning, or at least in R&D level of different kinds of platform systems which are essentially meant for ultra deep and deep water oil exploration production. There are different platform forms which are dominated in the structural design or in place and have been attempted by different industries in the recent past. And of course, we all now agree that looking into the economical consideration of this particular sector, foreign investments is one of the major source which should be attracted, provided if your scheme of E&P is more feasible and more techno-economical. Having understood this, let us now see what are those specific issues related to safety in deep water exploration production. We need to actually consider the system which offers good protection from hydrocarbon gases and safe inventory of gases. We should also know how to reduce the noise level of the platforms in deep and ultra deep waters. One should also understand how to mitigate by design or by process the extreme weather conditions, because in the last slides and last lectures we have already seen that accidents have occurred because of environmental or weather conditions happened during either exploration or during production or transportation. We should also essentially consider seriously educating the players who are involved in HSE and request them to go beyond life and assets, but also environmental protection, making them important. We must create increasing awareness amongst players that HSE leads to sustainable business. Generally, many industries, unfortunately friends, look HSE as an investment which is loss in the profit, which is not correct. We must educate people that HSE or safety practice will only lead to sustainable business which will improve production and therefore a good name and fame for oil and gas industries. Considering the factors which will contribute to boosting HSE in deep waters, we must ensure practicing HSE norms very strictly. We must ensure high degree of compliance of all the rule-based regimes in the practice of safety. We must also nurture safety culture in all facets of exploration and production. We must involve constantly and continuously training personnel to understand possible risks and hazards. This is where this particular course plays a very important role in capacity building of safety engineers in oil and gas industries. We must involve and encourage worker participation in safety issues. This is a very important feedback loop which will enhance safety as a practicing tradition, but not as an educational media. We must also focus on managing aging installation. This is one of the important problem, because many of the installed facilities have already lived their life or lived their production life at least. We must pay attention how to enhance the safety if we continue to use these aged installations. And of course, we must focus, and we have been focusing on asset integrity, which is one of the important factor which is an economic loss prevention as far as safety standards in oil and gas industries are concerned. Now let us have a golden saying to understand: safety is everyone's responsibility. It is not the role to be played only by the management. You cannot solve a problem with the same thinking that created the problem, as Albert Einstein clearly stated. Let us now understand what are those procedures one must follow if you have got an hazardous gas release protocol available in your exploration production platform. Whenever gas release is alarmed or suspected, you must train the people to do the following: shut off all spark producing devices. For example, it can be vehicle movement, can be mobile equipments, etc. Please request that or instruct that all spark producing devices should be immediately and instantaneously shut off if you feel or sensitize a possible gas release hazard in a working area. Observe the wind socks to know the wind direction. This is very important. You must have experience as a practicing engineer or a safety engineer. Wind socks plays a very important role physically to identify the predominant wind direction on any given day and any given time. So please observe the wind direction, because it is very essential to create a culture that organizing safety is very important, and every individual should be self-trained and self-motivated and directed, such that people do not go towards the windward direction, but they move in the opposite direction, so that if at all any hazardous gas is released, it does not spread along the direction where people are moving. Evacuate the area rapidly on foot in crosswind direction is very important. Do not re-enter the affected area unless declared safe. This is very important. It is not only necessary that you be safe and make your co-personnel safe, but do not try to go overboard saying that you will re-enter the area affected and keep on saving more assets and people. That is not required, because you are not trained to do firefighting as professionals of firefighting are unable to do it. Let us organize again a question of safety in terms of HSE. Let us look at the important points which will definitely make important deviations or diversions in organizing safety in oil and gas industries. Stop work when alarm sounds or you suspect hazardous gas leak. Plus, please understand, stopping work does not mean you got stopped the complete production to a halt, because oil and gas industry is very important that recharging the facilities, maintaining the operation temperature and pressure is actually a big challenge. Therefore, do not take individual decisions at your level, but kindly report the near miss immediately to your plant manager, so that take steps immediately does not mean that you have to stop work. Stop work in sense, you must communicate to people about the hazardous sensation which you are experiencing. And of course, redirect people and yourself to go to the nearest assembly point, because every industry has got a safe assembly point which is declared and educated to every personnel working on board. Use proper personal protection equipment. This is very important, briefly called PPE. You must know and you must use all the proper personal protective equipments. Follow safety rules strictly and adopt procedures given to you or you are trained on. Every industry should have an hazard identification plan. Contractor must conduct hazard identification tours periodically to identify the hazards at work site. Check and obtain certificates for a proper working of all personal protection equipments. If you talk about fire prevention, then this can be achieved successfully by essentially a good housekeeping, controlling the threshold quantity of storage of flammable and combustible material is one important and major step you can do yourself the controlling or achieving effective fire prevention. Friends, fire generally spread only when a good quantity of flammable material is available at inventory. So, prohibiting smoking in restricted areas will certainly help to avoid or to miss one of the important elements of a fire triangle. Firefighting equipment and training should be given to all necessary personnel, and you must conduct periodic inspection to check whether these devices are working properly and they are in place and they are recharged. It is important that you must conduct fire checks at end of shifts. This is very important because generally shift transfers or shift handovers is the point which is vulnerable for fire hazards. So, end of shift for fire checks should be carefully examined. It should be certified by the person who is handing over the shift, who is receiving the successive shift also. Please report unsafe conditions and practices to the fire officer or security which is involved in your company. Another important area of what people should be educated is emergency reporting. How do you report an emergency situation in your plant? State that this is an emergency, this is very important. Describe the emergency very clearly. Do not try to set panic with people. Say, what is emergency? Is it because of fire? Is it because of gas release? Because the emergency evacuation ideas and procedures are entirely different for different conditions of emergency, because the emergency plan of evacuation cannot be similar to that of a fire accident compared to that of a gas release. So, do not try to set a panic unnecessarily. Clearly describe the state of emergency, give exact location of emergency, state if there are any injuries. Do not try to hide. In fact, do not hang up the telephone, that is very important. Convey the message and leave the telephone available online, because people like to contact you for more information. Give your name, ladies and gentlemen, without any fear, and disclose identity very clearly with so called badge number, who is reporting from where and who is reporting on what. That is important. Stay kindly online to receive further instructions. Do not take your own decisions in case of emergency, because people who are trained for emergency evacuation plan or specially skilled personnel who are capable of instructing people for safe evacuation. So, do not take your own decision. Kindly stay online to receive further instruction from the safety or fire officer who is in charge of safety evacuation plans in your plant. Now, let us see what are the steps involved in carrying out safety inspection in kind of hydrocarbon process plants. The first and foremost thing which comes in a safety evacuation plan or safety operational list is fire extinguishers. Please prepare a checklist based on the questions asked on the slide. Now, are the extinguishers available on site? Are they located properly? Are they properly mounted? Are they suitable for the type of fire suspected? Because there are different kinds of extinguishers, dry, wet, deluge, etc. You cannot use one on the other kind of fire. Please see what kind of fire is expected from your plant or from your machine shop, and try to see and check whether appropriate and proper type of fire extinguishers available in your plant. Are the seals of the fire extinguisher intact? Are they loaded and charged? Most importantly, friends, please check whether the inspection tag is up to date, because sometimes on emergency, fire extinguishers may be available in position and place, but since they are not recharged, they are not tested properly, you will not be able to use them effectively. So, please constantly keep on inspecting this, and this checklist should be prepared at least once in a month, and you should be keep on augmenting this so that the fire officer is informed about any lacuna available on these questions as far as fire extinguishers are concerned. The next list comes is a fire water systems. Are fire water mains and pumps tested as per schedule? Because there is a regular inspection check which should be scheduled for checking the fire water mains so that they are in position and they operate in the required pressure and temperature. The next one is the fire water monitors. Are these monitors in good condition? Are the swells functional? Are any leaks evident? Are wrenches provided in place where they are to be provided? Are hydrants in good condition? Are caps provided for outlets properly and they are closed? Are all the valves properly oriented for for access by the firemen. It is very important, sometimes in case of fire the walls becomes inaccessible for the firefighting personnel. Please see that these walls are properly oriented and they are properly displayed, and a chalk and the list is available on the plan for a fireman to easily locate in case of any emergency. Talk about hose reels. One must check whether they are in good condition, whether the nozzles provided in the hose reels are available or crank handle operable. Sometimes it is very clearly and commonly seen that the hose reels crank handle are damaged and you cannot hold the hose reel for firefighting. Sometimes these hose reels being kept in a closed conduit condition, there can be enough leaks available in the hose reel. Please check that they are leak proof, and also check whether the deluge systems available in your place are properly tested as per the schedule, or foam systems tested as per the schedule. Coming to the next point is the work permit, which is one of the important area where people generally foresee lot of lacuna, which results in hazardous situation or which results and ripens into a serious accident. Are work permits properly filled out? That is very important. Are issue certificates valid? Is work permit in use available on site for reference? Are conditions listed adequate for the job? Are correct permits issued for jobs attended? Are conditions listed being followed strictly during the work permit? The next important, which is also equally necessary like a work permit, lockout and the hold tag. Certain areas during work permit you do not allow access for personnel. This is called a lockout area, or sometimes the work is continuous, you call this an hold tag. You have suspended the work for some requirement of an inventory or a material or for a specialized personnel, so you have to put a hold tag. So please check, is system properly isolated before you carry out such work permits, and is the system that plants do check. Is system properly isolated and de-energized? Please check that in operational systems and offshore and oil gas plants, the plants work on a specific temperature and pressure. So please note that de-energization should be carried out before the work permit or the work area is isolated for carrying out any repair. The system properly locked, chained and tagged so that there is no misuse of the system while repair is being carried out. Is the tag properly filled out? It must have an authorized signatory who is allowing this kind of isolation and the whole tag. Are the tags and locks installed as per the requirements of the personal safety equipments? When you come to personal protection, which is very important and very alarming, let us see what are the steps to be asked and what are the questions to be followed so that personal safety is at most achieved. Are suitable personal protection devices available? Safety shoes, eye protection glasses, helmets, gloves, aprons, earplugs, etc. Are they available in place? Is evacuation plan clearly explained, available and tested in case of emergency? We all understand, especially people working in the industry know, people used to conduct what is called as a fire drill. Fire drill is a mock drill conducted once in a periodic interval, so the people working on board are given a proper physical 1:1 scale training so that in case of emergency they know how to react and where to go. Whereas students who are listening to the lecture, please understand, if possible visit a plant to know what is an emergency evacuation plan, how people are conducting fire drills. Are people trained in emergency rescue procedures? Is very important. In many situations, hazards ripen to accidents only when the personnel are not trained to act during emergency. It is very important, because generally during emergency people tend to take their own psychological decisions, which is not admitted and not good in case of safety organization in HSC. Special protection devices, are they provided and used? Safety belts, air supply hoods, chemical goggles, life vests, TL canisters and gloves, etc. Are they available in plenty and are they being used properly? Generally post accidents can be always mitigated well if you have got first aid equipments in place. or safety showers and eye wash equipments available. It's very important, friends, in case the visibility requirements goes lower and lower, eye irritations goes higher and higher, people generally become panic. So you require what is called eye wash equipments in available in place, and sometimes safety showers we call, they should be available in place, because you want to protect and prevent first level burns from people. You must have these kind of facilities available as a first aid equipment in your plant. Are they available within a specific range of about 4 to 4.5 meter of the potential hazard? You should not search for them. It's very important that depending upon the location where such experiences can be seen as a near miss in the past, try to provide these kind of facilities or first aid equipments within the closest possible range. Are first aid kits provided on job sites? Please check them. Are temperature, pressure and quality of water available for firefighting is satisfactory? Talking about lighting, is lighting adequate available in your plant? Is lighting suitable for electric area classification? Because there is a very standard procedure available in the literature to classify the amount of lighting available for electric area as well. So please check whether this is suffice in your plant. If not, insist on improvement on these kind of safety standards. Do lighting fixtures need immediate attention? Sometimes these lighting fixtures may be corroded, may be bending, might we have seen cracks, there are loose bolts, so they will cause hazard situation because they will result in electric spark immediately. Coming to the noise, because this is one important area where people cannot communicate each other when the noise hazards are very highly unacceptable. Are areas with the noise level 90 decibels are identified? Have you identified them? In such situation, do people wear personal protection devices? Are these areas labeled for ear protection? Are employees working in these areas of high noise level wear ear protection devices? You must ensure this by periodic inspection, conduct survey and report this to the plant executive, so that this should be insisted very carefully, because in most of the cases it has been observed that when people do not wear ear protection devices where the noise level is very high, communication becomes halfway. When the communication is not effective, then it results in a disaster which causes very serious accidents in process plants. Interestingly, we have seen in the case studies, power shuts off when there is an emergency or when there is an accident. So let us see what we talk about emergency lights in case of organizing safety. Are they first place available in your plant? Are they in working condition? Please do not take granted that the emergency lights placed in position are available in working condition. The battery should be available in recharged mode. The emergency lights tube should be properly placed. They are locatable and you must know and check whether they are in a proper working condition. Is the liquid level in the battery satisfactory? This is a very important check which one must perform, which is kindly and most commonly ignored in many of the plants. Is wooden stick available to check the battery level? This is actually, these are the lists available in most of the places where people carried out successful safety organization procedures which has saved lot of accidents. Please do not ignore these minor points, because they will know, they will come to a rescue when they have been asked to. People generally drop the hand tools and power tools then and there in case of emergency. Let us check whether these tools meet standard requirements. Are they free from defects? Are non-insulated electric tools properly grounded? That is very important, because it develops short circuit and that causes a lot of panic and results in serious accidents in case of any power failure. Are wires free of defects? Because this is the place where wires of a longer length subject to high wear and tear may get exposed off, the insulation would have been opened, and you must check whether these wires are free from defects. One of the important source of accident, unfortunately friends, in oil and gas industry is the cranes. Is crane operator essentially and very clearly certified to operate the specific type of crane? This is very important. Most probably in most cases in shift handovers, people try to compromise on the crane operator's maneuverability capacity or the crane operator's insufficient training. Please check whether the crane operator who is operating the crane is certified to operate a specific type of crane. Every operator cannot and he is not certified to operate all types of cranes. Does the crane has a valid inspection sticker placed on it which is certified by an authorized signatory? Is a trained and certified personnel available on board to operate the cranes? Most importantly, ladies and gentlemen, slings and life gears becomes very important source of causing accidents. Is the load exceeding safe working load? Because every sling and a life gear system in a crane is specified with what is called as an SFL, which is called safe working load or safe factored load. This is specified for every sling, rope, wires, etc. Please check whether these loads is exceeding by any way of operational standards. Is a hook redesigned for no sling displacement? That's very important, because the sling is not displaced properly, it may land up in drop down of the objects which cause serious accidents. Are the eye bolts of standard type provided in the crane? This is very important. Are shackles used for making connections, or they are simply tied up with the wire bolts? Because there is a standard procedure by which you have to hold down the object to the crane hook. If you talk about chemical store, one should also understand, is emergency showers and eye washers available near the chemical store and they are operable? Is proper fire protection system in place available with the chemical store? Are exit doors unobstructed and well indicated in the evacuation plan which is pasted near the chemical store? Are exhaust fans working properly? Because in case of chemical disasters, it has been observed that the gaseous hazards released in the environment cause a lot of panicity. Though it is not causing the challenge of life of people, but it results in a lot of panicity which results in a very serious accident. So let us check whether the exhaust fans are working properly so that the gas, if released, is dispersed in the environment and the content concentration of the gas release is brought down as early as possible. Are acids and flammables segregated in the chemical store? That's very important, because both of them are giving in different chemical characteristics, and that can cause lot of issues. Let us talk about relief valves. We always consider mechanical systems as one of the default friends which will come for a rescue in case of emergency, which is not the case in many accidents as seen in the recent past. Are these relief valves painted properly? And they should be, for example, painted in orange. Are the bellow type valves properly vented? Because if the venting is not proper, the venting is shut down by mistake, these valves do not operate successfully. Are all the release valves discharged properly? That should be also checked instantaneously and periodically. Let us talk about the checklist available for electric accessories. Are they kept in explosion proof box? Are all conduits supported properly? Are all conduits free of cracks, corrosion and other defects? Are they grounded properly and they are intact? Talk about tanks, pumps, compressor areas. Are the dike walls free of cracks? Are entry and exit of dike walls free of obstruction? Because this is a place where you must give enough accessibility to people. Is tank skirt free of cracks? Is fireproof system well supported and maintained? Is fire protection and firefighting system sufficient and adequate for firefighting in the tank, pump and compressor areas? Let us also check the control rooms and substations available in the plant. Are they adequate with fire protection devices? Are controls clearly identified? Are emergency equipment such as fire blankets available as required and stated in the rules and regulations? Is building pressurization working properly wherever required to do that? Let us check also the pipelines in place. Are they well supported? Are they free from defects? Are they free from leakage? Is dike wall provided around the pipeline or pipe racks? Is pipe area free of weeds and racks? This is a place very important where this will lead to lot of deposition which can cause corrosion on the pipe material on the external surface. You may not even notice because of the weeds growth and the racks around the pipe circumference. Therefore, we must focus on, friends, is it a good housekeeping maintenance done in the plant? Because this can prevent lot of the above points which can enhance and ensure safety in a given wall. Let us talk about the walls as well. Are the walls free of leak? Is working platform provided to operate the walls? Because in most of the cases, the working platform is not comfortable to operate a wall. Therefore, let us see, are they available in a comfortable situation? Are these walls clearly identified and labeled? Let us also talk about the boilers and furnace. Is the flame out protection provided in these boilers and furnace? Is sniffing steam provided so that the quality of air dispersal can be controlled under the regulations? Are PERT systems available? Because you want to reduce the concentration of gas release if it is expected. Are boilers and furnace adequately spaced? You cannot keep them close because they operate in a different temperature and pressure. Proximity of them will cause lot of accidents as an unfortunate situation in many cases. Are dividing toe walls provided between them so that they are isolated in case of an emergency requirements? Let us also see how the check protocol works. Generally, all these lists which has been tested and certified should be signed by a plant engineer who is designated a safety engineer in the plant. They should be concurred by a foreman who is responsible for every shift, and it should be approved fortunately by a plant superintendent. So this is a very important document. All these checklists must be tested, certified, and then to be pasted on record so that one should know that these safety procedures are periodically inspected and followed and they are adhered to. Let us quickly see what are the safety resources which comes in play. Loss prevention, industrial hygiene, safety coordinations, electric safety, after our phone numbers in the safety logbook. Friends, the last point is very important because generally in a safety logbook, the after our phone numbers are not written properly. In case of emergency, the plant personnel has left the plant because duty is over, he must be available, or at least phone number for contact should be available, because then only you can clearly indicate, or you will try to understand what are those safety violations which was expected by him in the previous shift or in the previous day. So after our phone numbers should be mentioned in the safety logbook as a part of the document. Clean and responsible shift handover report is a very important document which can enhance safety for sure in any process industry, my dear friends. You must conduct periodic meetings and you must revisit safety procedures. You must involve personnel who are interested to safety. What are the general safety requirements which we must now conclude? Work permit system, isolation, lockout, and use of hold tags if possible. Certified work permits, you must also guarantee the certified issuers and receivers of work permit. Calibrated gas testing equipments, use plant personnel safety equipments as required. Inspect cranes and AV equipments periodically. Certified crane operators should be only entrusted to operate cranes. Also, certified riggers should be used to operate the rigs. Certified radiographers should be allowed to carry out radiographic surveys, etc. Most importantly, kindly encourage a practice of good housekeeping, because this can prevent lot of accidents in a major disaster situation as seen in the recent past. You must designate smoking place very clearly. You must observe speed limits within the plant. You must make fixed operating hours. Friends, most importantly, kindly try to avoid overtime and shift spillovers, because this will cause lot of work fatigue to people, which results in major accidents. Use safety logbook and maintain it under the custody of the safety plant engineer. You must also prepare, very importantly, called hazard identification plan, which is called HIP. HIP is one of the important concept or one of the important component of human being. Similarly, HIP is a very important component in any considered process safety management. Hazards are generally identified as class ABC. Class A generally refers to the condition or a practice which can cause permanent disability, loss of life or part of body, or can cause extensive loss of property. This is called class A hazards. Class B hazards refer to condition or practice that can cause serious injury or illness or property damage, but they are less serious compared to class A hazards. Class C of course refers to the condition or practice that can cause minor injury or illness or minor damage to the property. So relatively class A hazards are more dangerous, which can ripen to accidents compared to that of B and C. However, nevertheless, A, B and C are equally important. One must prepare hazard evacuation and identification plan for different categories of hazards. All these issues come under a single concept called job safety analysis, very briefly called JSA. JSA is a process of determining physical requirements, environmental conditions and safety factors, those are related to specific job or task. So every job has to be performed with a JSA. What are the different merits you achieve by performing a JSA? Safety instructions do not provide safety details on performing jobs. Therefore, job safety analysis improves safety performance by practice, not by instructions. It improves safety regulations by better revisions. It is mandatory as per the safety improvement study rules, which has been now implemented in oil and gas industries in the recent past. It can provide pre-job instructions on irregular jobs. It is very important because job safety analysis will try to project on different hazardous situations which are not otherwise seen in safety as an end danger. It is a benchmark for accident investigation. It reduces accidents more or less in a given plant. More importantly, friends, it increases or enhances the employee involvement in JSA. That is very, very necessary for improving safety. Therefore, what are the essential objectives of such analysis? To identify possible hazards, to eliminate hazards. Where do you perform JSA? Very interesting question. Jobs where most accidents and near misses are reported, we must perform JSA for them. Jobs with potential for serious injury should be always reported under JSA. Jobs that are categorically new should be generally done under JSA. Jobs that are repetitive catches more focus under JSA because they are the jobs which are causing more accidents because people think they are experienced to handle the situation, therefore they can always be ignorant. Ladies and gentlemen, in this lecture we discussed essential protocols of preparing reports, surveys which can form an important document for organizing safety. We have seen the benefits of job safety analysis. We have insisted on how personal safety protection equipment should become mandatory for people and how by employer involvement and employee involvement, safety can be enhanced in a process industry. Thank you very much for listening to the lecture 9 on HSE and NPTEL IIT Madras.